Thank you, Pastor Mircea. Good morning.
Good afternoon.
So glad to be back here at Mississauga Victory Church and with my wife, just like last time. I know, like from our experience before, that we quickly run out of time, especially when I'm up here. So thank you, Pastor Mircea, for trying to give me a little bit more time. Hello to everybody that's online as well. Like, my mom is online. She's actually in the Philippines right now. She's actually been stuck in the Philippines since February and working on some family things that she needs to do. Hopefully, she'll be back in December. We don't know if she'll be back in time. Anyways, let's have a quick prayer, and then we'll get right into it. Father in heaven, wow, you are incredible. Lord Jesus, there is no one like you. You are greater. You are far above all other gods. They don't even compare to who you are. You are more than wonderful. You are great. You are holy. You are good. And you are amazing. So we come before you today. Give us ears to hear the voice of your Spirit speaking to us. And release a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that we could get to know you and your heart better. Thank you, O Lord God, for each person that is here, because each one is here not by accident, but because you have ordained for them to be here today in this place at this moment to hear this word today in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen, amen. It's kind of funny here. We were talking about just during the service and before the service. They were telling me, you know, where I can walk up on this stage, because I like to move around. Actually, I'm used to being down and talking to people when I speak, and I'm not allowed to do that here because I get out of the camera. And they told me that right here is the edge of where they lose me in the frame on the video. And what's really funny is everybody decided to sit over here. Right? There's only a couple of people over there, and everybody decided over here. So it's going to be a challenge for me not to swing over to this side. But let me start with this. Let me start with this story, a little testimony of my background. I'm actually a fourth-generation Methodist. So I grew up in a very traditional family. My great-grandfather was a bishop of a local Filipino denomination called the Unita Church. My grandfather was an ordained minister. He worked extensively with the body of Christ in the Philippines. That exposed me, of course, to that. Somehow, the calling to ministry skipped a generation. So my dad and his sisters and his brother, they are active in the church, but they're not serving as a pastor or anything like that in any official capacity. And then it hit me and I have two cousins, Joyce and DJ, who grew up in LA and Seattle, in the West Coast of the United States. And they're, both of them, I believe, have their master's degree for sure from Princeton Seminary. And they're serving the Lord right now over there in the United States. But I always, growing up in the church, when we moved here from, you know, we moved out of the Philippines when I was 4 years old, because that was the time that President Marcos actually declared martial law. And it wasn't good for people over there, that situation. My parents at the time were actually on vacation in the United States, in California. And my grandmother said to my dad, don't come back here to the Philippines because it's too dangerous now. So they stayed there, and I was sent over with a family friend to fly over to LA. I spent 2 years there. After 1 year, my middle brother joined. And then my third brother, my youngest brother, was actually born in LA. And then we packed up and drove across country, spent 3 months in Albany, New York, waiting for our paperwork to go through, and then we crossed the border into Canada, into Ottawa, where my uncle and my two aunts and their families were living, to be closer to family. And so I grew up in Ottawa, on the east end of Ottawa, called a little town called Orleans, which had only 10,000 people at that time. Lived, you know, one of the houses when I was in high school was right across a farm that the farmer had a lot of cows. He's a dairy farmer. And whenever I took the school bus into school for high school, we always had to wait in the morning for about 15, 20 minutes for the cows to cross. And then, but now, you know, now Orleans is a thriving, bustling community. It went from 10,000 to over 100,000. I think there's probably about 150 to 200,000 people just in the east end of Ottawa. And, you know, it was a big deal for us when we finally got a red stoplight on the corner of 10th Line and St. Joseph Boulevard. And it's like, we're getting big time. We got a light, right? And then we went really big time because we finally got a McDonald's in Orleans. It's like, holy cow, we're growing too fast. We're growing too fast. It's like McDonald's, oh my gosh. So I grew up like that, but I also grew up, because there was no Methodist church in Canada at the time, we ended up going to the church that my uncle and his family and my dad's sister, my aunt, and her family were going to, called St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church. I grew up in there, going to a very traditional church. And the Methodist church, as you probably know, is a very traditional church as well. And to be honest with you, I found church and religion very boring. Super, super boring. You know, the only reason why we went was because we were kids and our mom packed us up in the car to go. We didn't, you know, during offering time, she'd all each give me and my two brothers a quarter each to put into the envelope. And it was like, oh my gosh, you know, growing up, I thought in the Presbyterian church, you know, these ministers, they're not called pastors, they're called ministers, and they wear these black robes. Even in the summer, they wear black robes. And the associate minister actually became a friend of mine. He lives in Hamilton now, retired. And I said, I used to ask him, what do you do? His name is Willard. And I said, Willard, how can you wear that black robe in the summer? It's like, my secret is this. And then he took his robe and he went like this and he showed me. He's wearing shorts and sandals underneath that robe. I said, you dirty dog, you. This is what you do. That's how you get away with it. And to be honest with you, I never experienced God like we did, especially this morning. This worship this morning was amazing. And I felt the presence of God so powerfully this morning. And which goes to show, you don't need musicians up here to experience the presence of God. Because the presence of God does not depend on the talents of man. The presence of God is all who he is. He's amazing. He's wonderful. Just amazing. Anyways, so I grew up looking, you know, when I finally got spiritually hungry, I had to go outside of my church to find. I went to other churches, attended a Bible church that was there teaching the Bible and that kind of thing. Well, I found it to be super, super, super boring. And I didn't want anything really to, I wasn't really involved in the church. I wasn't really involved in the Sunday school or the youth ministry or anything like that. So, but one day I went to visit my grandparents. My grandfather had moved back from the Philippines and settled in with, living with my aunt and my uncle and my cousins in Seattle. And my grandfather felt called to start a church there, a small Filipino church, about 60 members. And I went there to visit. They were probably in their second or third year of the church plant. And I went to visit them. And one time we were going to have a welcome back party because one of the young people, one of the young people's brothers was in the U.S. Marines and he was coming back. He was being discharged. He finished his tour of duty and he was coming back. And so we had, in the Filipino culture, we have what we call a bienvenida, which is a welcome back party. And we also have despedidas, which is a going away party. So, and of course, at every party, there's food and that kind of thing. And after we ate, someone suggested, probably my grandmother suggested, why don't all of the young people, why don't you guys sit in the living room and have fellowship? Now, I had no idea what fellowship was. You know, fellowship was a word that was printed in the bulletin program of the Presbyterian Church, but nobody took the time to actually explain what fellowship was. So I had no idea what it was, but we sat around the living room. I sat on the edge of a couch, and my cousin was there, and a few of the young people were there. And this was a group of young people that ranged from being teenagers all the way into their 20s. Some of them were in high school, some of them were in university, and some of them were already working young professionals. And it was a kind of mix of about a dozen of us there. And they said, go and fellowship. So we sat there, and then people started to share with them, well, with one another. They started to open up and share the struggles that they had about being a student, being a Christian and being a student at the university, on campus, in high school, and at work, and that kind of thing. And that sharing turned into praying for somebody. We started praying for the people who were struggling. And I didn't know what was going on. I was not leading it at all. At this point, I was like 14 years old, and I'm wondering, what is this? What's this? This is fellowship? Okay. So this is pretty cool. And then all of a sudden, the worship leader, the young guy, his name was Cesar, picked up his guitar. And now I've never seen Cesar lead worship without his songbook, you know, with the chords. But his song, I saw his binder tucked away, you know, leaning up against the couch. And he was there sitting down, and he was starting to play these songs. And we began to worship, you know, songs like, things like, oh, let the Son of God enfold you with his spirit and his love. Let him fill your heart and satisfy your soul. Stuff like that. And turn your eyes upon Jesus. We started singing songs like that. But what amazed me was Cesar wasn't looking at the chord charts at all. He was had his eyes closed while he was doing this. And everybody else started just singing in and remembered the words. I didn't know the words at all because those songs were actually foreign to me. You know, I'm used to, in the church I grew up, I'm used to hymns, right? A mighty fortress is our God. And, you know, especially when I got exposed to like full gospel, freer churches, Pentecostal churches, you know, people are raising their hands. I couldn't raise my hand. I said, you know, that looks pretty cool. It looks nice to do. But, you know, I couldn't lift my hand any higher than this. You know why? Because through the years, I had been conditioned to hold the hymn book in front of me like this. And this is as far as my arm would go. But it looked so nice. But these people here, these young people in this living room, they were just worshiping and singing along. And all of a sudden, I found myself, even though I didn't know the words, I found myself feeling like there was something that came into the living room. Some presence had come into the living room. And we all started crying, bawling, not just crying, weeping, wailing, you know, just all sorts of bodily fluids flowing out of every hole in your face. I mean, everything out the nose, out the mouth, out the eyes, tears, boogers, you know, stuff coming out of the ears. It's like, oh, my gosh. And it was just, oh, my gosh. It was like something just went splat, you know, because it was so powerful. And next thing I know, I found myself underneath the coffee table in the middle of the living room, just weeping and weeping and weeping. And I had this experience. I had seen in my spirit, I saw a bright, bright, bright light. I mean, brighter than I've ever seen. And then a shadow of a cross. I saw this shadow of a cross. Then I heard a voice. And the voice was quoting this verse in the Bible, Romans 3:23, that said, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And I was just undone. I was like, woe is, like Isaiah. I didn't even know who Isaiah was. And I was like, woe is me, for I am undone. I'm a man of unclean lips, blah, blah, blah. And it was like, oh, I am done. I'm done. And it was so powerful, and I knew what I call that. When I share this, I call it, and in my notes, I actually, to remind myself of this story, I put this title, the close encounter of the God kind. And it was that. It was a close encounter of the God kind. And I got up from underneath that coffee table, off of the floor of the living room, sat back on the edge of that couch, changed, completely, completely gone, completely surrendered to God. And that changed my life. I came back to Orleans. Completely changed. My priorities were different. My language was different. You know, I grew up, my dad, had separated from my mom when I was 10 years old, and they finalized their divorce when I was in high school. And, you know, just had no role model growing up. So, my role models were? The guys that were in the movies, you know, people like, you know who my role model was? I had three role models. Probably just two main role models. You know who they were? First one was Eddie Murphy. Can you imagine? He's my role model, right? So my language was very profane, right? I was funny. I had a sense of humor like him. I could joke like, but the language is profane. And of course, Sylvester Stallone and Arnold Schwarzenegger, because this was the 80s, right? And they were big, and they were like, these were men. These were people I said, men, and I want to be like them, right? Because I didn't have a dad growing up. And so it was like, everything changed for me. My priorities changed. My language changed. All of that just was transformed completely because of this experience that I had with God. And it really, I know that it was with Jesus. Now, I want you to know this, that I never surrendered my life to Jesus at that time because of what he could do for me. There was no promise that he would bless me or that he would prosper me. There was no promise that he would heal me. I wasn't sick. There was no promise that, you know, he would heal my mom or my dad or my grandparents. There was no promise for anything. He didn't give me something for my surrender. I never surrendered my life to Jesus because of what he could do for me. I surrendered my life to Jesus because of who he revealed himself to be. And he revealed himself to be undeniably alive and undeniably holy. I share this story with you, this personal story with you, because one of the most fundamental problems that I've seen, I've been a pastor for over 30 years. I pastored 9 churches. Most of that time, I'm a speaker in different churches like I do here for you guys. I've probably spoken in front of hundreds of churches. I've been in front of tens of thousands of people. And I've done seminars and conferences. My wife has helped me with that because she's production director kind of thing. And I share this because one of the most fundamental problems that I have seen that I continue to witness today is something I brought up last week, which is that the church today, the church as we know it, is still operating in what I call the old covenant operating system. And the problem with that, and I didn't mention it last week, but this is the kind of change that I had to make, Marcia, when I emailed the new thing to you. Because what I realized this morning was that the fundamental driving force of the old covenant operating system, or old covenant framework, is quid pro quo. I got that slide there. Quid pro quo. You know what that means? It's Latin. And normally, you hear this in business. You hear this when business people are talking, quid pro quo. You hear this when lawyers are talking, quid pro quo. And quid pro quo means, it can be translated as tit for tat, this for that. You do me a favor, I'll do you a favor. You give me something in exchange for something I'm going to give to you that you value. That's quid pro quo. And what I realize is that the old covenant operating system and the way that the church operates today and the way that followers of Jesus and believers operate today in our relationship to God and even in our relationship with one another is that we operate in quid pro quo. That we operate this way. God, I'll do this if you'll do this for me. God, I'll obey this if you give this. I'll tithe as long as you give me back. I'll give as long as you give back good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I'll sow as long as I can reap also, if you'll help me to reap. Quid pro quo. And quid pro quo religion only leads to frustration, it leads to guilt, and it leads to feelings of defeat because it completely, quid pro quo religion, completely depends on your ability to keep your end of the deal. Are you hearing what I'm saying? You see this a lot. You read this in the Bible, Deuteronomy chapter 28 and 29. If you will obey these laws that I've set before you, these are the blessings that I set before you. In your going in and your coming out, in your, you know, in all that you do, in your fields and in your home, with your children, if you will obey me, then I'll give you this. Then I'll bless you, I'll prosper you, I'll protect you. We see this in Malachi. You bring the, as long as you bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to bless you. I'm going to open up, if you do this, I'll open up the floodgates of heaven. I'm going to protect your crops. I'm going to make sure pestilence doesn't touch it, and you're going to be blessed, and it's going to overflow. Test me in this, says Lord. That was the old way. The old way that God related to us was quid pro quo. That's the old covenant operating system. And it completely depends on yours and my ability to hold up our end of the bargain. And that's a problem. Because, you know why that's a problem? It's a problem because you and I cannot keep up our end of the bargain. We saw that in Romans, right? We saw that how the law became powerless. Why did the law, the word of God, how can it become powerless? Because of the flesh. It isn't that the problem is with the word of God. It isn't with the law. The problem, the law is perfect. But the law is not the problem. The problem is our flesh. We can't keep up our end of the bargain, so we lose out on the blessing. And that's a problem. That's really a problem. Because what it does, quid pro quo, or old covenant operating system, what it does is it turns the way of Jesus, if we continue on with it even today in our New Testament, New Covenant faith, if we allow that old covenant operating system to continue to operate in our lives, in our church's lives, in our ministry's lives, if we allow that to happen, we turn the way of Jesus into consumer Christianity. And consumer Christianity, the foundation of consumer Christianity, is quid pro quo. pro quo. You do this for God, God does this for you. So today, we're going to take the next step in understanding how to live in new covenant power. Living in freedom means being free from religious consumerism. Believers today live in the power of the old covenant by what? By focusing on three things. Now, don't get offended. Remember, we have a Q&A time. So if you need clarification, you can do that. But I'm about to say something that may offend you today. All right, here we go. Believers today live in the power of the old covenant by focusing on obeying the scriptures, gathering in sacred buildings, and following ordained leaders. In other words, let me say it not in such flowery language. Let me say it this way. We focus on the Bible, we focus on the church, and we focus on pastors. And that is simply wrong. Why is it wrong? Is there something wrong with the pastor? Actually, I don't know if there's anything wrong with the pastor. I've been living with her, beside her for many years. She seems to be okay. She does a pretty good garden, and she makes amazing cinnamon rolls. So she seems to be all right. I don't know if there's anything wrong with your pastor. All right? Oh, is there something wrong with the church? Is there something wrong with the building? Is there something wrong with having to meet in a place like this? Mark, are you telling us that there's something wrong with the Bible? You just said the Bible. The problem is our approach. The problem is that we still approach the pastor, the church, and the Bible quid pro quo. That's our problem. But Jesus completely and irrevocably fulfilled the old covenant and made such things, what's the word we used last week? Obsolete. Everyone say obsolete. I want you to turn to the person on the left and say obsolete. I want you to turn to the person on your right and say it's obsolete. Hebrews chapter 8 verse 13, I believe we do have a slide for that. By calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete. This is not my word. Don't be offended at me for using the word obsolete, because that's not my word. It's the word that's in the Bible. It's the Bible in Hebrews 8:13. Next slide, please. That says that it's obsolete. Oh, sorry. I took that slide out. Okay. And what is, he says, by calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete, and what is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear. So Jesus made the priesthood obsolete. Jesus made the temple obsolete. Jesus made the law, yes, the law, the one that Moses wrote, the one that Moses downloaded on the mountain, he downloaded from the cloud onto two tablets. Those 10 commandments and then the 613 commandments that followed after that, that you read in the Bible, he made them obsolete. What's wrong with that situation? What's so wrong about the church? What's so wrong about pastors, and what's so wrong about the Bible? Here's the problem, and we see this every day. We see this every week. We see this every Sunday. Here's what happens. In the old covenant framework, in the quid pro quo kind of spirituality, we expect our pastor to take care of us. We call it pastoral care. Marcy, when you went to Tyndale, right? It was Tyndale you went to. You probably took a class on pastoral care, right? There's that in the curriculum. Pastoral care. And so, because our seminaries promote it, because we operate with that idea of care coming from the pastor. So when you're sick and you're in the hospital, you expect the pastor to visit you and pray for you. Or when you're at home, you expect the pastor to show up. As long as you're not sick with COVID, she'll show up, right? You expect them to come. You expect the pastor to come visit you. When you lose a loved one, you expect the pastor to come and provide pastoral care. So here's what happens. In the old covenant framework, we expect our pastors to take care of us rather than getting that care from one another. The church was never designed to get care from a leader. The church was designed to get our care from one another. Love one another, bear with one another's burdens, forgive one another, pray for one another, heal one another, comfort one another, rejoice with one another, one another, one another, one another, one another. That's the proper operating system. What else is the problem? We come to church. Oh, now you're going to get mad at me. Because we come to church to be fed rather than equipped. And you see people, there's a phenomenon, you're probably familiar with it. There's a phenomenon called church shopping. Have you ever heard of church shopping? That's not the church going to square one, eh? That's not that. Another term for it is church hopping. People going from one church to the other church. Why? Oh, because you know what? This church doesn't have a worship team, so I'm going to go to a church that has a worship team. This church, you know, the kids' ministry sucks, so I'm going to go to another church. Oh, this church, you know, the pulpit ministry and the pastor, not a very good preacher. Probably a nice guy, but he's not a good preacher, so I think, or this church, the pastor goes overtime every Sunday. And I got to get out and make sure we have lunch and we get to go to our cottage afterwards. No, I can't do that. So I'm going to go to a different church. So we go church shopping, we church hopping. We look for the right church that meets our consumer needs. Quid pro quo. Oh, I'm not going to give to that church, not unless they step up their children's ministry. Why should I give 10% to a church that doesn't even have any musicians? Am I meddling now? I think I'm meddling now. And we come to church to be fed rather than to be equipped. Worse yet, some people don't even come to be fed. Some people come to church to be entertained rather than equipped. So what ends up happening? We end up becoming a stale institution rather than an unstoppable force in our society. And what does the world do? They write us off. They write us off as irrelevant. We don't even need to meet. Those people don't need to meet at all. So when COVID hits, they don't need to meet. Let's keep that away from them. Let's make sure that churches can't meet. They don't need it anyways. Why? Because they don't see the difference that we're making. They don't see the difference that our faith makes. Quid pro quo. We also see this in reading the Bible. Here we go again. Oh my gosh, I'm going to get into trouble. I'm already in trouble. But we read the Bible, and we treat the Bible like it was written by Napoleon Hill. Think and grow rich. And we search the Bible for the keys to unlock success and prosperity and abundance. When we approach the Bible, are there blessings in the kingdom of God? Absolutely. I believe it. God blesses us. He blesses us with abundant life. He blesses us with abundant peace. He blesses us with provisions. He blesses us with blessings that we don't deserve. But the purpose of the Bible, you know, I actually had someone say this to me at a church one time. Guy approached me and he said, you know, I believe that the Bible is the greatest self-help book in the world. Self-help book? Are you kidding me? Do you know what Jesus says about the self? Kill it. Jesus is not trying to develop yourself. He's trying to kill you. He's trying to get you to die to yourself so that you can gain true, real, authentic, abundant life. See, here's the thing. The secret to living in the power of the new covenant is believing the gospel and following the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm going to unpack that because there's a lot of presuppositions about that statement I just made that you have in your mind. But the secret to living in the power of the new covenant is believing the gospel and following the leading of the Spirit. Why is believing the gospel so important? And yes, not just to start the Christian life. You don't need to believe the gospel just to start the Christian life. The gospel is not just the ABC of the Christian life. The gospel is the XYZ of the Christian life. And the reason why that's true, why do we need the gospel now? The gospel isn't elementary. The gospel isn't just milk. The gospel is our nourishment to grow, to mature, to become more holy in the Lord. We need the gospel. It's not just there to get born again into the kingdom of God. It's not just there to be part of the Christian family. That's not what it is. It is our lifeblood. This is what we need. Why? Because the root of all sin, listen, This is an important statement. The root of all sin and spiritual defeat is idolatry caused by unbelief. You're struggling in your life. If you're struggling in your marriage, you're struggling with your finances, if you're struggling with relationships, if you're struggling in your life, chances are that there's an idol in your heart. Chances are there's something in your heart that is more important than Jesus. It's called an idol. And you're obsessed with that rather than obsessed with Jesus. And your life is out of alignment from the gospel. You know what Jesus calls being aligned with the gospel? He calls it righteousness. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Seek the rule of Christ in your life and being in line with the gospel, and all these things will be added to you, he said in Matthew 6:33. So by making the old covenant obsolete, Jesus prepared a better way with a better message. And that better way and better message is known as the gospel. So here's where we're going to go back to that and say, what is the gospel? What is the gospel? The gospel is not the four spiritual laws. The gospel is not steps to peace with God. The gospel is not the Roman road to Ephesus. While those tools, one written by Billy Graham, another one written by Bill Bright of Campus Crusade for Christ, and another one that's used with Evangelism Explosion to share the gospel, those aren't actually the gospel. What is the gospel? The only way for us to know what the real gospel is to go back and read about in the Bible, in the New Testament, especially in the book of Acts, go back to the first gospel message. The one that was preached by Peter on the day of Pentecost. Because it's the same gospel that he heard from Jesus. Now Jesus, when you look back on that, in Mark chapter 1, verse 15, Jesus starts his ministry with this declaration. The time has come. The kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the gospel. But it's so short, right? How do we know what does that mean? So how we know what that means is the way that the apostles, starting with Peter, preached that same message. So let's take a look at that in Acts chapter 2, and we'll look at the message that Peter preached on the day of Pentecost. There's a window in the middle of the screen here that might need to be clicked or something. I'm not sure. It's been up there for a while, actually. Acts chapter 2, verse 36, 37, 38. I'm going to give some context to it too. And I'm just going to highlight verse 36. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Now, why do I just focus on that right now? The reason for that is this is the summary of Peter's message to the people in Jerusalem. So getting the bigger context, this is the day of Pentecost. The disciples were meeting for prayer after the resurrection. Jesus had been crucified. Third day he rose. For 40 days, he showed himself to the disciples. There was a 10-day period from that weekend where Jesus was crucified and rose from the dead. 40 days, he showed himself. And then another 10-day period before the day of Pentecost came, 50 days. And on that 50th day, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit gets poured out. 120 disciples locked up in a house, locked up in an upper room, and the Holy Spirit comes upon them like tongues of fire. They begin to speak in different languages, different dialects. And they burst out into the city of Jerusalem, which was filled with tons and tons of people because they were all coming there for the Passover and for Pentecost. And these were Jews from all over the world who had learned how to speak other languages, just like you. Some of you here may have come here to Canada for the first time. You didn't speak English. You may have spoken something else. You know? And like Filipinos, we do this too. We're scattered all over the world. We get to learn the local language. We learn, right? We learn French. We learn Arabic. We learn, we learn Italian. I remember I was in Argentina one time for a conference, and I was at this Chinese buffet. I was having dinner there one time, and there were all of the waiters were Chinese, and you know, you could hear them talking to one another in Chinese. They come to me, and I don't speak Chinese, and they start speaking Chinese to me because they assume I'm Chinese, but I'm not Chinese. I'm sorry. I would like to order this, this, and this. Oh, okay, sorry. They spoke English. And then they would go to another table. This table was local. They're Argentinians. So that Chinese waiter, who was speaking Chinese with his friends and speaking English to me, all of a sudden started speaking in Spanish. I'd never seen a Chinese guy speak Spanish before ever in my life. I said, holy cow, this is amazing. It's a sign and a wonder. Because I was looking for the signs and I was wondering what's going on. And it was like, wow. And this is what was happening in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago on the day of Pentecost. And people were wondering, what is going on? Peter rises up and begins to explain. This is how his sermon begins. His sermon begins with explaining why everybody's speaking in tongues, why everybody's speaking in these languages that they could understand. So he says, this was prophesied before from the prophet Joel. And he quotes Joel chapter 2. He says, this is what happened. And God said he was going to pour out his spirit on all flesh. And this is that happened. And by the way, the reason why this happened was because Jesus, whom you crucified, was raised from the dead and went back to heaven and gave the Holy Spirit. It's Jesus who's responsible for pouring out the Spirit on all these flesh to be able to do this thing that you're wondering about. Oh, and by the way, this Jesus, he's resurrected. By the way, this Jesus fulfills the prophecy of the Davidic covenant because God promised David long ago, and then he quotes the Psalms and he says, I will let a king rule on your throne forever, David. And this Jesus, from the line of David, from the family of David, was that fulfillment, and he's now raised from the dead, and he poured out this Spirit, and this Jesus, whom you crucified, whom you killed, God raised from the dead, and he made him Lord and Christ. Therefore, as a result of all of this, as a summary of us, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this, God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. Now, throughout the book of Acts, and I challenge anyone online or here in the congregation, I challenge you to read through the book of Acts several times and take a look at all of the instances when the gospel message was preached by an apostle. Preached by Peter, preached by Philip, preached by Stephen, preached by Paul and Barnabas. All of the times that the gospel message was preached in the book of Acts, and throughout the book of Acts, the gospel message was never a message of quid pro quo. It was never a message, if you repent, God will forgive you. If you repent and believe, then God will bless you. If you repent and believe, God will prosper you. If you repent and believe, God will bring you up of wherever you are. It was never that kind of message. The kind of message that you hear today, that's not the message that we read about that is preached in the book of Acts. Was never a message of quid pro quo. Neither the apostles Peter, John, James, Barnabas, and Paul ever enticed the people to believe in Jesus because of what he could do for them or what benefit Jesus offered. Then, here's the question. What compelled people to believe? If it wasn't an enticement for healing or prosperity or forgiveness, what enticed people to believe in Jesus? If it wasn't quid pro quo. Here's the message. Listen again. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. What do we mean by that? What we mean by that is this. This is what Peter meant. This Jesus, whom you crucified, is Lord. He's raised from the dead, and being raised from the dead means that he's Lord. That means that Jesus is the Lord of heaven, who is greater than Caesar and greater than the oppressive worldly empire that you're a part of. Greater than the worldly system that you're a part of. He's Lord. Now, in those days, okay, in those days, people in the Roman Empire, especially Roman citizens, used to greet one another a certain way. Because they had, this is their way of thinking. Caesar was the head, the emperor of Rome. The reason why Rome is so great and have taken over the world is because of Caesar. And Caesar is great because he is the manifestation of God on the earth. That's what they thought. Very similar, today we still have that. The Japanese emperor is considered to be a manifestation of God. But you know today that he's mostly a figurehead, not functional. But in the day, 2,000 years ago, in the Roman Empire, he wasn't just a figurehead. They weren't speaking metaphorically. They really believed that Caesar was God in the flesh, ruling over the Roman Empire. So when Roman citizens greeted one another, they greeted each other with, "Hail Caesar." Hail Caesar. Or, "Caesar is Lord. Caesar is Lord. Caesar is Lord." They were confirming and affirming that Caesar was God in the flesh and that he is the greatest power on the earth. When Christians believed, they heard the message and they believed the gospel, they believed that Caesar was not Lord, but that Jesus was Lord. Are you hearing what I'm saying? The gospel message was a subversive message because it challenged the spiritual and political aspect of their life. It challenged the powers that be, saying, "I am not loyal to Caesar and the Roman Empire. I am loyal to King Jesus and his kingdom." And if you ever said that, if you can't say, if you're truly a Christian, there's no way you can say Caesar is Lord. Because you really don't believe that. You believe that Jesus is Lord. Imagine how hard it was. We think it's so hard to be Christians in our world today. Imagine not even being able to say hello. Because people will find out that you are not loyal to the nation, to the empire, and you're not loyal to our political leader. Right? That's what it means, that he has made him Lord. Then he says, not only Lord, but Messiah. Which is appropriate because his main audience, his main hearers are Jewish people. And the Messiah was the king that they were waiting for, the king that was prophesied thousands of years before. The promise that there would be a king that would sit on the throne of David forever and rule over the earth, not just rule over Israel. The Messiah was an eternal king that would rule over the entire earth. And what did they say? When they say that Jesus is Lord and Messiah, they're saying Jesus is Lord of heaven and earth. Again, another subversive message. Jesus Christ is greater than anything or anyone that you have made to be your king. Think about this. Jesus Christ is greater than anything or anyone that you have made your source of security, your source of self-esteem, your source of pleasure, and your source of peace. Nothing that you put in your heart that gives you peace, gives you security, that gives you identity, that gives you self-esteem, that gives you confidence, nothing you put in your heart compares to who Jesus is. Only Jesus deserves that place. He is greater than anyone who has ever lived. He is greater than anyone or any material thing that exists today. And he is greater than anything that exists in the realm of the spirit or human ideology, because Jesus Christ is Lord. The cause of every sin and every defeat and every powerless moment in your life comes from idolatry due to unbelief, because unbelief replaces Jesus with something that you think is better. Unbelief says that Jesus is not enough. It says that I need something other than Jesus to be satisfied. I need something other than Jesus to be secure. I need something other than Jesus to be successful. I need something other than Jesus to be content. Unbelief, and here's the thing, unbelief is the struggle of both non-believers and believers. You know what that means? It means it is possible to be an unbelieving Christian. What? How can you be an unbelieving Christian? Isn't that like, how can that be? Because Christians are supposed to be believers. Yes, they're supposed to be believers, but you and I know from our own experience that we may start off declaring that Jesus is Lord in our life, but it's very easy to spiral down and make other things more important than Jesus in our life. And we become unbelieving believers, unbelieving Christians. Money can be your idol as a Christian, because money promises you security. Sex, pornography can become your idol because it promises you pleasure. Trauma that you've had in the past, abandonment, abuse, can become your idol because it gives you an identity. Some of us, we can't let go of feeling like a victim or looking at ourselves like a victim. What happens if you take that away? If you take away the fact that I was abused, if you take away the fact that I was betrayed, if you take away the fact that I was abandoned, who am I? And it becomes our idol because it promises us an identity. And all of these things and more can become more important to you than Jesus. Quid pro quo. These idols promise you something as long as you bow down to them and remain loyal to them. But the good news is that Jesus is alive. He's alive. He's alive, I say. Jesus is alive, and that he is Lord and Christ. He is greater than all the things you think you cannot do without. Jesus is greater and better than the things that are so important to your heart. So the question is this, and I know I'm running out of time. I'm actually over time already, which cuts into a little bit of our Q&A. But it's so important to finish this off. How then should we respond to the gospel? If the gospel is that Jesus is Lord and Christ, if the gospel says that only Jesus should be sitting on your throne, on the throne of your heart, if the gospel says only Jesus can provide the things that you desperately need in your life, if the gospel invites you to make Jesus the king of your life, how do you respond to that? Acts chapter 2, verse 37. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" When you hear the message that there's no one like Jesus, when you hear the message that Jesus is alive, that he can rule over your heart, when you hear the message that Jesus can be a part of your life and that he's inviting you to be part of his kingdom, how do we respond? This first audience in Jerusalem, brothers, man, you're right. What should we do? What are we to do next? I want you to note something here. That when Peter answers this question, what do we do with that message? I want you to note that a sinner's prayer or accepting Jesus into your heart are responses to the gospel that you never find in the Bible. You never find someone say, if you want to become a Christian in the Bible, you want to come into the kingdom of God, accept Jesus in your heart. You don't see that in the Bible. He said, what must I do? Imagine the Philippian jailer to the Apostle Paul. Sirs, what must I do to be saved? What does he say? Pray the prayer. Pray the sinner's prayer. Never. Never. Because that is not the response to the gospel of the kingdom of God. What does Peter say? Verse 38. Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of sins, and then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And what we see here, and I'm not going to go into it because I'm out of time, but there are four responses. It's not a quick prayer and then I'm a Christian. It's a path that you walk. What is that? I'll throw this up on the slide here. I think go back one. Oh, I didn't put it in. Okay, let me do it this way. Four things. Repent. What does it mean to repent? It means to renounce your loyalty to the God that you've been serving. That's what repentance is. Have you been serving your ego? Have you been serving your greed? Have you been serving your anger? Have you been serving your trauma, your pain? Let it go. Stop being loyal to that. Repent and believe. Believe that Jesus is greater than your pain. Believe that Jesus is greater, that he offers you greater security than any business, any amount of money could ever offer to you. Believe that Jesus is alive, he's real, and that he can fill that void of loneliness that's in your heart rather than all of those girlfriends or all of those boyfriends that you are pursuing. Jesus is greater. And then Peter says, repent and be baptized. And be baptized. Oh, wait a minute. Why do we need to be baptized? Here's what baptism does for you. It's not that when you get baptized, somehow that convinces God to accept you. No. Baptism is actually for your benefit. You know what that benefit is? It gives you a physical and emotional and psychological experience of dying and then being raised to life again. When you get dunked in that water, I joke people when I baptize them, I tell them, now when I baptize you, remember, this is your graveyard. And when I put you down there, I'm going to keep you down there until you're dead. Then you're going to be raised back to newness of life. And I don't mean like physically dead, I mean like you're spiritually dead, to make sure that your old life is dead, right? Dead, and then raise you back to life, you are a new person. And we need that. Because if you see, if you read in the New Testament, whenever we have issues with holiness, whenever we have issues with sin, the Bible never goes back, the New Testament never goes back and says, stop sinning because you know the Word of God says, don't do this. Never says that. It never says, you have to stop being addicted to pornography because Jesus said, thou shalt not commit adultery. And if you look at a woman lustfully, you're committing adultery. So stop it. That's not what he says. He says, this is the approach. This is the gospel approach. He says, why should you stop sinning? You know why you should stop sinning? You should stop sinning because you are no longer the person you were before. You gave that up before. Jesus got rid of that already. You died to that pornography. You died to lust. You died to anger. You died to that victim mentality. And you're raised into newness of life. Start walking in who you really are. I love that song that we did earlier. I know who I am. Whoo, that was powerful. That's where it started for me. It's like, wow. First song, I think it was. Powerful. Powerful, powerful. And then he says this. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ. Repent, be baptized, believe, and then you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that's the fourth thing. That's what seals the deal. Think of it this way. You're being initiated into the kingdom of God. You initiate into the kingdom, into the fraternity called the kingdom of God. And when you initiate into the fraternity called the kingdom of God, you have to give up all loyalties to any other fraternity that you belong to. And you have to commit yourself and believe that this fraternity is the best, or that the head of our fraternity is the best. And now we're going to haze you. We're going to haze you. We're not going to make you dress up like a hot dog. We're not going to make you put on a dress and go around door to door selling Girl Scout cookies. Here's what we're going to do. Here's our hazing. We're going to kill you. We're going to put you in the water. You're going to die. You're going to be raised into newness of life. And here's what God's promise is to you. When you repent and you believe, and you take that first step of obedience by being baptized, God will pour out His Spirit, and you will receive the Holy Spirit into your life. You will be adopted into the family of God. It will be a deposit that guarantees your inheritance, and you will be transformed from the inside out. That's what happens when you go from darkness to light, when you go from the kingdoms of this world to the kingdom of God, when you go from being an unbeliever to being a believer. Modern Christianity teaches that we need the gospel to be saved. Yes, everybody agrees on that, to start our Christian life. But it also teaches that we need more to grow and mature. Today I'm telling you that the gospel of Jesus Christ is sufficient for our spiritual growth. That Jesus is the beginning and the end. He is the Alpha and Omega. And we can experience true spiritual power and freedom in our lives when we continue to believe the gospel and follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. You need the gospel to be born again. You need the gospel to start your journey as a Christian. But you need the gospel to grow as a Christian. Why? Because even Christians sometimes get idols in their heart. And we forget that Jesus is greater. Sometimes we forget that He's more wonderful than my eyes can see. He's more wonderful than I'd ever think He could be. He's beautiful. He's amazing. He's good. And sometimes we forget that. And we think our job or our business, we think that our dreams are more important. We think that it's our dreams that will fulfill us, but when really it's Jesus that can only do that. We think that the bread of the world can satisfy our hunger, but only the bread of life can do that. We need the gospel every single day. I'm going to throw up one last slide. And this slide, I'm not going to even teach on it because I don't have time. I want to have the Q&A for the next 10, 15 minutes at least. But this is what you do. Oh, the next one after that. Well, I sent another slide that had that. That was from last week. Yeah, there you go. These are the steps that we take to apply the gospel to our lives every day. Every day we examine ourselves ruthlessly and we regularly identify and renounce any idols that are in our hearts. We need to do that. We remain confident in Christ. We hold on to Him, that He's our all in all. He's what satisfies. He is greater. We reinforce our identity in Christ. We rely on the leading of the Holy Spirit, and we need to reconnect with a spiritual family for strength, comfort, and encouragement. Because sometimes we have blind spots. Sometimes we don't see that we've turned something into an idol. And we need someone that we trust, a group of people that we trust who are filled with grace but speak the truth, to show us and expose in our own lives that we have idols in our hearts so that we can believe once again and walk with the Spirit. And that's how you apply the gospel to your life every day. We need this to grow up in Christ. Amen? Amen. Pastor Marcia, let's do a Q&A now. Do you have any questions? Or even online, for those of you online, you can type your question in the chat. How many of you have been challenged today with that message? How many of you think, now you don't have to confess it or open it up here, but how many of you think that you might have some idols in your heart? Okay, we got some questions. Great, great, here we go.
Dancing where you prophesy, still shout.